Okay, I will call the December 18th, 2019 Franklin Township Board of Supervisors meeting to order at 7 o'clock. That's a record. In attendance are Supervisors Dee, Marsh, Schneider, Torres. Also in attendance are Solicitor Mark Thompson, Harb and Historical Commission Chairman Paul Legasi, Township Manager Joe McGraw, Secretary Sharon Norris, and there are four members of the public. All rise for the pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
With the public comment section of the meeting, public comment is for anything related to items on tonight's agenda. The last public comment is for items not on the agenda. It is important that you state your name clearly for the tape so your comments can be reflected accurately. Please state whether you're a township resident or township taxpayer. Typically, in a meeting like this, we'll take public comments throughout the meeting. So the supervisors will discuss the issue, and before we vote on anything or make any decision, we'll open up a public comment. Do you have any public comments now? Hearing none?
Can we start? I make a motion to approve the November 20th, 2019 version 2 meeting minutes as presented by the Township Secretary.
I'll second.
Seconded by Donna. Discussion?
Just for the scout here, meeting is recorded audio here and also video here. After the meeting's over, the secretary will record, listen to that, and convert that into written minutes, which we're going to approve shortly. But this one here, since the minutes have been converted from voice to text, this motion allows us to delete the recording. So the official minutes will be in writing, but the videos are available essentially indefinitely.
And over here you have a copy of the minutes from last month, so that's kind of what we've done. So this is being recorded for today's meeting, but when it was done last month, that's going to be gone. And then you have a written minutes, and you have this copy of it. Okay, so I'll make the motion that John was talking about.
We didn't vote on that one.
We didn't vote on that one.
Oh, yeah. Okay, so we had our discussion, right? All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed say nay. Motion carries 5-0.
Can I jump in?
That's okay.
So I'll make the motion that talks about deleting the audio from the last minute. So I make the motion that the Board of Supervisors adopt Resolution 2019-19 regarding the disposition of records for the Board of Supervisors meeting of November 20th, 2019, and the Planning Commission's meeting of October 3rd, 2019.
I'll second that.
Thanks, David. So that's seconded by David Snyder. Any discussion? This is pretty basic stuff. So all in favor say aye.
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 Any opposed? Okay, so the motion carries 5-0.
Make a motion that the board approve the November Treasurer's Report, which includes the following disbursements. The general fund with disbursements and transfers of $143,343.43. Park and Recreation Fund with disbursements of $5,790.08. And the Open Space Fund with disbursements of $6,553.17. The Capital Reserve Fund with disbursements of $11,253.75. And the Fire Hydrant Fund with disbursements of $580.80. Leaving a balance in all funds totaling $688,679.41.
Second.
Seconded by Stephen. Any comments on the Treasury Report? Errors? Upgrades and
so
questions.
I do have a comment. It's not an error. It's just that Jen, I think you really run a tight ship, and I think if you look at the 2019 budget, you see that we don't have a whole lot of exit flying around here. Or, you know, our park and recreation is I know it's in the negative. It's all going to work out. It's the numbers are low, much lower than they were last year. And I think it's because, you know, money that's allocated is being spent because it's being managed appropriately. But I think my message to the public is there's not, we don't pad, it's just, it, you know, it is what it is. We have a reserve fund, and that's what's, you know, gives us that little extra in case we do need some additional. But in terms of the categories themselves, you run a pretty close, pretty tight budget.
Talking.
Yeah.
What is a negative park fee as income?
It was an NSF check that went in the end of one month, and the bank took it out, so it's a negative. And then they replaced it, so this month it's going back in here.
So someone bounced a check on us?
Okay, just for the scout's information, the treasurer's report is a monthly compilation of all the costs and income that the township incurred during that month. So what we do is, we have a budget, which we'll talk a little about later, that shows what we expect to spend for the whole year. It's really a spending plan. Not that we know exactly what we're going to do, but it's a spending plan. So every month, a treasurer report, which are actual numbers of expenses and income, are compiled, and that's compared against the budget. So you look at your budget spending plan and the treasury report that month, and you're going to look at how your costs are going. So are you in line with your budget, or you're not in line with your budget? So the idea of cost control is if you see that you're overspending something, you need to back something else down or make a correction or whatever. But the treasury report's an important document. It provides every transaction, every financial transaction that the township gets through. So every penny, down to the penny, is accounted for. And we account for it in a software program called QuickBooks. So it's a database program, so it's very well organized.
I'd like to ask a question too. Based on everything that, you know, we've been reading in the paper and everything about Kennett Township, does anybody have any questions about the way we deal or I deal with everything here? Or
Do you do a better job than they do over Kent?
Well, the one thing that they had that we won't have is a supervisor stamp for checks.
That was, I can't believe the things that I cannot believe that there was no oversight.
That nobody saw that. That's
lady really, just, oh, I'll take care of it, and then no one ever.
And the supervisor got very lucky.
Yeah, and yeah. Now they want to, apparently they had a, was it last night they had a big meeting, and the people wanted the supervisors to resign.
There's a video about out there somewhere, but I didn't see it.
Right, and
Sharon, you couldn't find the video?
I couldn't.
Supposed to be a video available at that meeting, because a lot of people decided not to go because the video would be there.
One of the things I'd like to point out, if you look at our, when you see our treasurer's report, and if you look on our website, all this financial information is there. We publish the budget, the treasurer's report every month is there. And if you have the time sometime, look at other township websites. They don't put anything out there. It's, you know, and even Kennett, until this all happened, they had a one-page report, and they would group expenses together, such as payroll expenses, and it was like $15,000. And it didn't say who got what or how much or. So I mean, I try to do this, and we've got a lot of checks and balances in place. Some of them made it the recommendation of our auditors, and we put them in place. And so I think, you know, we do a good job here. And I just want to relay any concerns anyone has. If you have any questions or.
No, I think you do a very good job in terms of there's nothing that gets done with at least two signatures and usually three.
Well, my end has to be right because I'm writing that check.
And so there's not, just so the public knows, there's checks and balances everywhere. What you said for credit cards, you don't have a credit card, but a chairman does and Jeff, and then you have to approve it. So there's always a backup. You know, you guys are looking out for each other and you're making sure that there's a record of everything. So I think you've done a great job.
I've appreciated very much your meticulousness. Is that a word? Meticulousness? In fact, you're very meticulous and very honest.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you.
Very, very good keeping us informed of where the money is going at all times.
And the supervisors meet once a week informally. We're only two supervisors because it's not public, but purpose of that meeting, the weekly meeting, is to sign checks and review the expenditures for the following week. So supervisors are sitting at the top of just everything, and we alternate supervisors, so it's two different supervisors every week.
You're lucky to have you.
This one, Kenneth, it's hard to believe.
I can't believe.
$3.8 million.
Yeah, it's hard to.
There's one that's even worse than that, if I remember.
It's a horse queen.
All the queen's horses. Did you ever see that?
Saw that mirror.
Yeah, that was $53 million over.
And a poor, you know, not a big income community.
It should have been, though. What was interesting is the neighboring communities wrote them letters and said, we always have an excess of funds. Why are you borrowing money all the time? What's wrong? And the supervisors didn't even look into it. They're bored or whatever.
Well, they had a mayor.
They're mayor, okay. But they didn't look into anything. And like I said, the surrounding townships were telling them, there's something wrong somewhere.
They should have a 5-member board, not a 3. They have the same population we do, and they should be having a 5-member board as well.
Well, like one of the problems, I had one person who answered the phone, opened the mail, wrote the checks, did the books.
Yeah.
And that's.
How many years was that 3 million plus?
10?
It was over 10 years.
10-year period.
Yeah.
She was
aggressive at the end.
20 years.
Next year, 440,000.
And they raised taxes too.
Well, she's currently in Puerto Rico because she's got a house down there. Did we vote on this?
Yeah, no,
we did not.
We did, okay.
No, we did vote.
We did vote.
I seconded.
He seconded, but yeah, I don't think we had a vote.
No.
Okay, so on the motion for the treasurer's report, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carries 5-0.
Next is the November zoning officer's report. There is no motion attached to this. It is simply a report. The number of permits issued was 12. Building inspections conducted were 32. Building fees collected, $1,973.76. There were no open space, recreation, or impact fees collected, but there was miscellaneous fees collected, $1,525. That sounds pretty normal. Was there anything specific that?
No.
Just a normal?
I mean, you had a lot of inspections.
Spread out? No.
Yeah, a lot.
What we call miscellaneous. And there's one ongoing zoning issue to report. You're still talking about that?
Well, the Appleton Road. And, you know, we did go to court with that and the.
Right.
And I talked to Max and asked him why we weren't getting any money from the Judge Shankin's decision. We were supposed to be paid money.
Right.
And he says that the property owner is making small monthly payments.
How much was the total fine?
To the court. The fine was $750, and I don't know what court costs were. So
is he paying $25 a week or something?
Whatever, but we haven't seen anybody yet.
Do you have an estimate, Mark, as to when he's going to have this paid?
We have additional charges pending.
Yep. We are working on a ordinance that will probably go through the works next year to tweak our historic district ordinance, because the judge said the way it was written, it wasn't clear that these were violations. So now it's spelled out. Max, we did it.
The demolition by neglect provisions weren't necessarily clear. We were able to, convince the court that, nevertheless, despite the language, that there was a violation. But I mean, for future, we're making the suggestion that language be modified.
And Jeff is waiting to issue more citations as soon as that ordinance is approved and enacted.
Is there a document that the firm accepted a payment term? And
no, that's just between the court and the defendant.
The court collects it, and then they'll send us a check.
So if there's no financial need that I can get away paying $5 a week, or
he made a deal with the court and you weren't part of that.
So it was acceptable to the court.
It was a hardship.
So the most that we can do right now is continue to
review the property and you know, make additional complaints to the court if there's a continuing violation. So I understand that he did make some changes to the property.
He did start doing some work about a week or so before we had to be back in court, and he worked on the foundation doing the pointing with the stones, and he did do a nice job there, but there's a lot more that needs to be done. So as I said, as soon as the ordinance is approved, then Jeff Vogel's ready to start hitting him again. And the fines now, according to the ordinance, will be $1,000 per day. So, and every day is a new violation. So if he doesn't do something,
that's the maximum, so the judge gets to impose the fine. Rarely do they go to that, unless there's egregious behavior, but...
Well, maybe when he's taking back for the third time, and like...
Just a general overview, it's a historic property right here on Apple Road. It was left in disrepair for a long time, and the porch fell off.
Porch collapsed.
Collapsed, and that drew attention to it, and there... because it's in the historic district, there's a requirement by the historic district that the property be maintained externally in a certain condition, and the owner has not complied, so we've been involved with numerous court actions with this particular owner. He's been non-compliant. So that's the quick overview.
Thank you.
The next member of the PC, which I assume will be Donna, will give a summary of the December 5th meeting.
I mean, I can do that if you want me to. It's just, we're still continuing to talk about the ordinance.
We don't have a minute yet.
Yeah, so I mean, it's a continuation of the discussion. I think we're making progress, but it's going to go into next year.
I think the one comment I was at that meeting was that we were using the DDT guideline, that 7-page document, as a guide. But the PC realized that that really wasn't law. It's just a recommendation by the DEP, and we were going to reference, they were going to reference that document, but decided that they couldn't because it's not law. So they're going to put in the proposed ordinance what the requirements are. That was a key decision.
Yeah, it was a good one. And I think the also discussion was to treat it like we treat any other property when it comes to impervious surface and not to be onerous and not on, but just to be very consistent. Mm-hmm. And so, like I said, they're still working on it, and the board will get to see it once. But there, I mean, it's a lot of work, and then it's a good group of guys to go through and try to do the right thing.
Well, since they don't have a whole lot on their agenda, they've been pretty much working to about 8:30, and they decide we're going to work to 8:30, and it usually runs to not quite 9 before they cut it off. Right. So.
All right.
Okay.
Next, Chairman Paul
Lagasse
will report on the December 3rd Historical Commission meeting.
Thank you. So on December 3rd, the Historical Commission met, and as it so happens, we also had a hardcore due to the overlap on membership of the two boards. The meeting was held primarily because of the last joint part of the Historical Commission meeting. We did not have a Historical Commission quorum, so that we had to meet the requirement of meeting once a quarter for the Historical Commission. We basically recapped what we discussed at the previous HARB meeting, which was to review the discussions that had occurred with PennDOT concerning the 896 roadwork. We also talked briefly about the Churchill African Church Cemetery, which I hope to wrap up the investigations of that in the early part of the new year, say the first half. I'm not sure anybody's going to have an easy time tracing up to do research in Westchester if the weather turns bad and there are timing issues. But we do have the offer of help from a volunteer on that, and we'll start moving on that. Now that the historic resources map, which had been a focus of work this year, as our work on that has been completed, and that was turned back over to the Chester County Planning Commission and Karen Marshall, who is the Heritage Preservation Officer. This, of course, I reported all of this to you at the last time I was reporting the HARB. because this is essentially just bringing the historical commission up to date. In, we did have a nice turnout when Marshall Becker spoke about the Lundy in New London, and we talked about upcoming talks in New London in March. We're going to have a talk about women spies in World War II.
Oh, wow, that's awesome.
And then in May, author Bruce Malday will talk about Johnson again. So we do have the talks lined up for the rest of the season, and we're beginning to talk about possible talks for the 2021 season. And isn't that pretty much it?
Go next. Mm-hmm. So, Jim, you want to report on what's going on with FSA?
Sure, just a few activities since last month's supervisor meeting. Sorry I wasn't able to make that. I had some medical procedures that day.
But you're fine, right?
Oh, yeah. I'll live through another day. I guess the biggest things, the fall archery season closed November 29th. The fall, early winter shotgun season opened November 30th, closed last Saturday. Somewhat productive season through the gun season. Seven additional deer were harvested in the properties. I don't know, it did just to me, with the opening Saturday, this was a new day, I'd expect to see a little more activity, and I did see that. I was upstate for opening day, and it was even quiet up there. I'm very surprised with those change in the rules this year. But for total, you know, so far, 10 deer have been harvested. The 26th of December, the seasons will open up again. Hopefully you're gonna get out there a little bit more. I wasn't lucky enough to get anything so far this year. Saw a couple big ones, but they were just a little too far to do anything about. From a service project standpoint, we did on the 24th do the road cleanup on Chesterville. A little wet that morning, but we still got out there. The good news about it is we're consistently seeing less trash along the roads. You know, from the first time we did it, you know, we had 20 bags of trash, and this time we had 2 bags of trash. And even Creek Road, surprisingly, we didn't find a lot over the bank. In the usual dumping spot. And come back to you, the Girl Scout picnic table was the service we was finished. It was pretty beat up, so the sports room down there. Nice. They do a lot of work down in the park, so they sanded it down and stained it or painted it, whatever it was they put on the coating to refinish that to get it through the winter. And then some, and the club, as another community service, has adopted a family, and we'll be spending upwards of $400 on gifts for them in the local community. I'm not sure. Avonburg School District, so it may not be in Franklin, but it's Avonburg.
It's in the area, yeah, that's good.
Overall, in talking to the different club members, and we will have our meeting tomorrow night here at the township, there's no safety issues that has popped in and out of my inbox. I haven't heard anything of them finding non-members hunting in any of the preserves, which is a good thing. We've had that situation in the past. So everything's good. Weather's nice. There's still plenty of deer out there.
They're everywhere.
They're I usually see them when I'm in my truck.
Of course.
But we appreciate the opportunity, and hopefully the weather will hold out and get too cold, and get out there a little bit more after Christmas.
Thank you. Jim, thank you for your report.
Yeah, thank you for all you do for us.
And I said the total number, we peaked it up there over 150, and we still got 6 months to go. So that's.
But the next hunting seasons are late December through near the end of January. So just the guys that are real diehards go out there. That's pretty rough weather to be standing still.
Yeah, just plow the road down through Franklin.
All right, very good. Jim, thank you for your report. All right, so let's see if we can get into we get into the business part of the meeting. Not a whole lot of items in there. And I think what we'll do, because they're not two difficult items. I think we'll read the motions first, have a discussion, and then decide how we're gonna vote on it. So I'll just read the next one. First business item is related to some crossing park rules. I make a motion that the board enact ordinance 2019-03, updating the operating hours of Crescent Park and allowing the use of barbecues.
I'll second that.
Seconded by David. Okay, the issue we have there is the local hunting club, represented tonight by Jim German, installed 5 barbecue grills down in the park as a community service thing. I don't know where we got, somebody gave them to us, or we bought them?
No, we bought them.
We found a good deal on the bottom.
So, the rules typically didn't allow barbecuing in there, so since we installed barbecues and encouraged people to do it, we had to change the rules, so. We changed the operating hours. Sean, what's the details of the operating hours?
Sun up, sun down.
Sun up, okay. So there are two issues. Any discussion?
No. And this was presented at the last meeting, right?
Yeah, so we have to vote on two meetings. Yes. It was advertised, so now we are. Yes. In action.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. So will the gates be open 24/7 now?
Sunrise to sunset.
Sunset to sunrise.
So it's going to have to be closed when it's dark. You're just being a smart. I'm just wondering who's going to be out there at sunrise to unlock them.
Oh.
Well, the front parking lot is always open.
Okay.
And the back lot, Jeff unlocks it on his way to over. So, I mean, if somebody wants to play tennis at 6 o'clock in the morning, they can go in and do that.
Okay.
And then John Hawking closes them.
Yeah. I know John takes care
of
it. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, nay. Motion carries 5-0. Okay, let's get the next one.
The budget one. Yes.
I make a motion. Are we finished with that? The final budget?
Oh, no, you got final budget. Well, it's been advertised and we
okay.
We have to prove it now. Unless someone has any questions or anything.
I make a motion that the board adopt resolution 2019-20 approving the 2020 final budget.
I'll second it.
Seconded by John. Any discussion?
So we did at the last meeting, John went through it line by line. I think we had a pretty good discussion. Jeremy answered any questions that we had. So I'm very happy with it.
Oh.
Everyone's had a chance to read it?
Mm-hmm. Discussion was last month, so now we've advertised it and approved it. So.
Okay. But if you have any comments,
Dave,
you can
welcome. No, none for me. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Motion carries 5-0.
Great.
Next up is tax levy resolution. I make a motion that the board adopt resolution 2019-21, the tax levy resolution setting the township tax rates for 2020.
Second.
Second, David. Discussion. And these are the same as last
year. Yes,
yeah.
The point two, I just want to confirm, because the point two for the parks is still the point two.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because last year's when we made the change.
The total millage is 2.49.
Yeah,
one half. And then the EIT is 1.5%.
Yes.
So they were going the same.
Yeah, 2.95.
Okay.
And just for the public to know, is our expenses continue to rise, but as I said, Joan does a really good job of managing it, so we don't have to raise taxes. So we work very hard to control costs, so we don't have to raise taxes. So we look, once again, we can save that.
Cost control is really the key. Of watching your expenses on a weekly cost control on a weekly basis, so really nothing gets very far ahead of us. So in a week you can make adjustments. So
Joan,
if you wait a month, it's a little long, but
yeah. Sorry. As you look forward, what's the one cost that you worry the most about?
Emergency emergency services. I mean, we have to have it.
Right.
And it's just.
You have no control over it.
We have no control over it. It just keeps, now it's for fire, EMS, and Medic 94, so.
So that's still volunteer parking, or is that all?
Well, Medic 94 is a volunteer.
Right, right.
That's the advanced life support, but the fire company and their ambulance service, it's becoming more paid now than volunteer.
The ambulance service has got the biggest percentage of paid staff.
Which you can understand, you have little volunteers there.
Just to kind of put this perspective, emergency services in general have been increasing about 6% a year, and that's been pretty steady. That's been the same this year for fire, and for also Medic 94, which is some specialized, high-quality medical service. But the regular ambulance service went up 23% this year. And the reason, very simply, is call volume. They've just got more call volume, they've had to hire more staff. And the fire company, on the fireside, mostly are nearly volunteers, there's some office people that are paid staff, but they're all volunteers. But in the ambulance service, it's almost all paid staff. And, you know, of course, that's salary benefits and all the things that a regular employee gets. So one of the main things we get from the fire company is not only high-quality professional service, but all this volunteer time. If we did not have those volunteers, the cost of fire service would be astronomical. Just thinking of things that could get in our way later on, there's a lot of discussion out there about charging the townships for state police service. That's out there, and state government's been putting that out for the last 3 years, and the noise is getting louder and louder as it goes along, but I'm not sure how that's going to play out.
And now people have a hard time absorbing it. It's not that we have, like I said before, there's not a lot of money hanging around.
It could be a $150,000 a year charge to the township. So we have a budget that's $2.7 million, so $150,000 is not a minor expense. That would come out of some capital program. Hopefully that doesn't happen. I guess the other one that's still kind of hanging out there is MS4. That's another unknown expense that could come out. This is for stormwater management in urbanized areas. So those are the items.
And the bridge.
And the bridge.
And the bridge.
That's the bridge, yes.
So I guess as a takeaway, there are things we can control and there are things we can't. So we just do the best we can with what we can control.
The MS4 is interesting because it just changes all the time. We could have a meeting next month and there'll be some new guidelines given, and whatever we've done so far might be the goalpost could have moved to.
But until they approve it, we don't have to implement it.
No, that's right. When you look at the budget, it's $2.7 million. So that's a fair amount of money for a small township. But when you look at the cost of that budget that you have control over, you don't have control over a whole lot of it. We've got discretion on maybe 750,000 of it. You can kind of manipulate, but the rest of it's just spent.
Right.
You know, your costs that you cannot avoid.
Well, we're doing a good job, so we don't have to raise taxes for next year, so that's a good job.
Okay. Any further discussion? Is he okay with us?
Yeah,
I'm
good.
This is the one I said. Did you second it? Or did
I second it?
Okay, so all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Nay. Motion carries 5-0.
I make a motion that the board adopt resolution 2019-22, setting the tax rate of $36 per household for households who live within 750 feet of a fire hydrant. Seconded by?
I'll second that.
Discussion.
And just to say, the number that's not going up is what you've been charging.
Yeah, because they haven't raised their rates.
It's like a pass-through, right?
The homeowners that live within 750 feet of a hydrant do have to pay this additional monies. But it's a minor cost compared to the savings they get in their homeowners insurance by being near that hydrant. So, yeah, it's just the cost.
How many fire hydrants do we have in the town?
Eleven.
That is a really small number.
Well.
It's just not much, this is not much more than just rural hearts. This isn't Kenner Square, the city of Philadelphia, where you have water mains on every street, so.
I might have five of them in my neighborhood.
You probably do, there's two at Lookout Circle.
Windermere, no, Windermere, right by where I live, by Stonegate, on Broad Run, there's that.
White Plain on.
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, it's right there. I remember me, right by where I live.
Well, in any case, it's a very small number, and.
Yeah, it's not my favorite.
So there's not that many people involved.
There's about 150.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because, like, we had the GIS from the county do a map for us, and they, you know, they do the circles wherever the 700, what is it, 750?
They would expect to be located near a lot of homes.
Now, they, you take out like farm fields, they don't have to pay anything, it's just for homes. But I, the little story, I was really surprised, when we first implemented this, I got a phone call from somebody, asked, you know, like, what does this mean, I have to pay this tax? And I said, oh boy, here we go. And she said, I want to thank you.
Oh, wow.
She said, I called my insurance company and told them, and they lowered my bill by $1,200.
Wow.
That's insane, John.
It's a bargain.
Wow.
So she was tickled to death.
Good trade-off.
Can we make money on this?
Yeah.
I was, you know, I was worried I was going to get that taken off.
You know, when these stuff kind of costs, we just want to pass it through, we don't want to.
Yeah.
Just like our building inspection fees, we don't make any money on that.
We lose money.
We collect that money.
Barely, yeah.
The cost of administrating it and paying for a building inspector and all the paperwork that goes along with it, we just come out even on those.
We are not allowed to make money on that.
Oh, okay.
And we don't want to.
No, we don't want to, but I mean, we are not permitted to do that.
Can we put fire hydrants wherever we want?
I saved $1,200.
You want one by your house?
Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, say nay. Motion carries five to zero. Great.
So now we're getting into staff advertising for 2020. So Joan, before I read, I guess you want me to read, and then we'll talk about the dates, because there's a date you want to bring up.
Well, there's just a question about the full board meeting in January.
So do you want to have that conversation first before making a motion?
Whatever you want to do, Donna.
What's the rules, I don't know, I was going to just.
You can do it either way, works either way.
Okay, let's have a discussion, let me get it done. So Joan has a proposal based on the calendar for January.
Well, our meeting is scheduled the third weekend, or the third Wednesday of the month, which is the 15th, and the first is a holiday, and so the banks are not going to get bank statements to me probably until about the 6th of January, which gives me a very short period for reconciling and doing the report. So the question I was asking, because the books would have to go out on the 10th then, if there's possibility to consider moving the meeting for 1 month, does that mess you up?
1 month or 1 week?
1 week, I mean, this was just 1 month.
That's what I'm thinking.
Can't be the 22nd, so if it could be Tuesday, the 21st.
Why can't it be the 22nd?
I'm just saying, I'm a business trip.
Donna will be here.
Oh, that's right, Donna.
If we're going to move it, I mean, does that work for you on Tuesday?
21st?
Yeah. Is that okay if we do that?
Sure.
Your advice for that?
We'll check with Mary and Dave, but I'm assuming that's going to.
Okay, so then we'll just change that in this advertisement.
And you know, they go to six, they have to be here.
I think Joan's talked to them.
So that's just a monthly meeting?
That's just a monthly meeting for January.
So the first meeting.
Is a reorganization meeting on the 6th, that's okay.
That will be on the 6th.
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to change it to Tuesday, January 21st.
The auditors, that's to be determined, that's usually.
Well, the time is to be determined.
Right, right.
You have that set right here.
Yeah, it's eight o'clock on the Tuesday.
Eight o'clock?
8 o'clock AM.
On the 7th.
We're talking about the auditors.
Oh, the auditors.
The elected auditors.
Okay. All right, so I'll read then?
Yeah.
Okay, so I make the motion that the Board of Supervisors authorize the staff to advertise the January 2020 meeting schedule in the next available edition of the Daily Local News. Can I have a second?
I'll second.
Nancy.
Okay, so Nancy has it. And do we need any more discussion?
No, we said.
Yeah, I think we did, so all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? So motion carries five to zero. See how easy it is?
This was the fastest one I can do.
not much going on.
Hey, we haven't gotten through public comment yet.
Okay.
I see a future Board of Supervisors.
Don't do it.
Do the FSA instead, right? It's more fun for the heart.
No public comment?
You're a lucky child.
All right, we have something else to do yet?
Do we have to sign something? Do we need to sign tonight?
No, you're the chair. All right, so do you want me to, so I just wanna, this is your guys, our last meetings with us. And we didn't want to go without some kind of notice, and so Sharon and Joe and the whole crew got together. I want to give you a gift of appreciation for all the great work you've done.
Thank you for all the great work.
And we hope that we haven't lost you, that we'll still have you around to ask for your help, and there's a lot more work that needs to be done. So let's see what it is. You guys have a lot of knowledge.
Plenty of volunteer boards.
A lot of time.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow, it says Franklin Township on it. Beautiful.
Very nice, very nice.
Nice job.
Thank you, thank you.
Thank you very much, thank you.
Now you won't forget us.
See, the tennis court.
Steve's still gonna do our books, of course, though, I'll do it. He's still gonna be up.
Thank you for your service. Appreciate it.
So these gentlemen, 6 years have been on the board.
Oh, okay.
Contributed quite a bit to our success, so we wanted to be able to say thank you.
Yeah, thanks, guys. It's been fun.
You know, the board's constantly changed, but luckily.
And scales this.
Ken Cross.
He just walked in and he brought.
He brings it back to us, he makes it, so he brings it back to us.
Tell him I said thank you. This, I'm gonna leave here. I don't know what.
I don't think anybody wants it anyway.
It gave me some heartache over the years, as you know.
Yeah, we should have gotten Chromebooks, is what we should have gotten.
We probably should have, but it worked.
We tried.
So I'm just gonna close this up, and then whoever, if you wanna clean it out or throw it away or whatever, and there's the charter board.
Okay, thank you.
Before I close this meeting, was there anything planned for after this thing?
Well, we got some cookies.
If anyone would like to.
I thought you said something.
No, we don't have a job. No.
No, there was no exec session, so. Okay, so we've got public comment done, so we're ready. The meeting is adjourned at
43?
7:43. That's a record.
This is good. You guys pick a good meeting. Very well.